As You Like It, Part 3, The Shepherd Youth. Orlando, in his new life, did not forget the lady whom he had seen at the wrestling match, and who had so quickly won his heart. As he had no chance of speaking to Rosalind, the only way in which he could show his love was to carve her name on all the trees and perpetually write verses in her praise, which he hung all over the forest. "Hang in there, my verse, in witness of my love," he would say. "Oh, Rosalind, these trees shall be my books, and I will trace my thoughts in their bark, so that every eye which looks in the forest shall see your praise everywhere." Rosalind came across some of these papers and wondered greatly who the person could be who thus carved and hung her name on all the trees. But Celia, who had found some of the verses, was able to enlighten her, for she had happened to see the writer. On hearing that it was really Orlando, Rosalind became quite excited, and Celia had no time to answer half the eager questions showered on her before Orlando himself came that way. Rosalind now, for the first time, rather regretted her boy's dress, for of course Orlando did not recognize the cousins in their present attire. But at any rate, in the guise of a saucy youth, she determined to have a little fun, and presently a whimsical idea occurred to her nimble brain. Seeing how disconsolate Orlando was, she suggested to him that she should pretend to be really his Rosalind, and that he should address all his affectionate speeches and verses to her exactly in the same way as he would have done to the real person. If he did this, she said, she would soon cure him of his love. Orlando replied that he did not want to be cured, but all the same, he was perfectly willing to go every day to the shepherd's cottage and talk to this youth as if he were really Rosalind. The plan succeeded admirably. Since he could not have Rosalind herself, it pleased Orlando to be always talking about her, and he did not notice how much in earnest this half-jesting companionship gradually became. As time went on, the exiles from Duke Frederick's court made other acquaintances in the forest. Touchstone had found an object of interest, which served as an excellent butt for displaying his satire. This was a rustic goatherd called Audrey, a simple, not bad-natured girl, but one of the very stupidest and most ignorant specimens of humanity possible to imagine. Touchstone seemed to be quite fascinated by her extreme silliness, and, out of sheer perversity, declared he meant to marry her. As for Audrey, she was perfectly unconscious of any ridicule he chose to lavish on her, and followed Touchstone about like a willing little slave. Rosalind and Celia also had come across Jaques, and the latter would willingly have become closer friends with the shepherd youth, but Rosalind's sunny nature had nothing in sympathy with this cynic. "They say, you are a melancholy fellow," she said one day, in answer to a suggestion from Jaques that they should become better acquainted. "I am so. I love it better than laughing," he replied. "It is good to be sad and say nothing."
"Why then, it's good to be a post," remarked Rosalind.
There were many different kinds of melancholy, Jaques explained, such as the scholars, the musicians, the courtiers, the soldiers, etc. His, however, was a melancholy of his own, compounded of many different ingredients, but especially due to reflections over his travels. "Yes, I have gained my experience," he ended with mournful satisfaction.
"And your experience makes you sad," quoth Rosalind. "I would rather have a fool to make me merry than experience to make me sad, and to travel for it too."
But the joyous free life of the forest was drawing to a close, though much happiness was still in store for those who had wandered there. A day came when Orlando, for once, failed to keep his tryst. He had left Rosalind, promising to return within an hour, but in his stead, there came to the two cousins a stranger bearing a handkerchief stained with blood. Briefly, he told his tale. Orlando had been walking through the forest when he saw a wretched man, ragged and unkempt, sleeping under a tree. Round his neck, a green and gilded snake had twined itself, and its head was just poised to strike when, seeing Orlando, it glided away under a bush,
But the peril was not yet over, for under that very bush couched a famished lioness, watching like a cat to pounce on the sleeping man the moment he should stir. And having seen this, Orlando approached and found it was his brother, his eldest brother. Remembering the cruel way in which Oliver had always treated him, his first impulse was to leave him to his fate. But his better nature conquered. Orlando did battle with the lioness, who quickly fell before him. "And in the noise of the struggle, I awakened from my miserable slumber," said the stranger. "Are you his brother? Was it you who so often plotted to kill him?" asked Celia.
"It was I, but it is I no longer," said Oliver.
Orlando's noble behavior had completely overcome his malicious nature. All evil thoughts against Orlando were banished, and for the future, the two brothers were the best of friends. Oliver was made welcome by the Duke and was afterwards talking to Orlando in his own cave when his brother, calling on the name of Rosalind, suddenly fainted. His arm had been badly torn by the lioness and had been bleeding all this time. Oliver revived him, bound up the wound, and after a little, Orlando, being brave of heart, begged his brother, stranger as he was, to find his friends at the shepherd's cottage and explain to them why he had been unable to keep his promise. He sent the handkerchief dyed in his blood to the shepherd youth, whom he had called in sport his Rosalind. On hearing of the peril through which Orlando had passed, Rosalind was so moved that she almost betrayed herself by fainting. Oliver was somewhat astonished at such weakness on the part of a youth, but Rosalind tried to pretend it was only a counterfeit. Her pale looks, however, showed too plainly that the swoon was no counterfeit, though she persisted in declaring it was, and bade Oliver carry back word to Orlando how well she had pretended to faint. The sweetness and grace of Celia made so strong an impression on Oliver that he soon fell deeply in love with her, and as she was equally attracted by him, and as he was now quite converted from his formal evil nature, it was agreed that they should be married without delay. Orlando did all he could to help forward the wedding, though the sight of his brother's good fortune made him realize only more clearly his own unavailing love for Rosalind.
"They shall be married tomorrow, and I will bid the Duke to the nuptial," he said.
"But oh, how bitter a thing it is to look into happiness through another man's eyes."
"Why then, tomorrow? I cannot serve your turn for Rosalind?" asked the real Rosalind.
"I can live no longer by thinking," said Orlando.
"I will weary you, then, no more with idle talking," said Rosalind. "Know now that I speak to some purpose. Believe, if you please, that I can do strange things. I have, since I was 3 years old, conversed with a magician deeply skilled in his art. If you love Rosalind as heartily as you appear to, then when your brother marries Eliana, you shall marry Rosalind. I know into what straits of fortune she is driven, and it is not impossible to me, if it does not seem inconvenient to you, to set her before your eyes tomorrow, human as she is, and without any danger."
"Do you speak in sober earnest?"
demanded Orlando, scarcely able to credit what he had heard.
"I do on my life, which I value tenderly, though I am a magician. Therefore, put on your best array, invite your friends, for if you will be married tomorrow, you shall, and to Rosalind if you will."
The promise which appeared so amazing to Orlando was, of course, easily kept. And the following day, when the Duke and all the wedding guests assembled to witness Oliver's wedding, Rosalind and Celia appeared without their disguise and in their real attire. This banished Duke found a daughter, and Orlando found his Rosalind. In the midst of the wedding festivities arrived the second son of Sir Roland de Boys, bearing the tidings that Duke Frederick had been converted by a religious man and meant to leave the world in all its pomp. He bequeathed his crown to his banished brother and restored all their lands to the lords who had been exiled with him.
In the general chorus of pleasure, there was only one discordant note. Jaques the cynic. Melancholy Jaques refused to join in the harmless mirth. He announced his intention of following Duke Frederick into retirement. He bade the others all follow their different forms of enjoyment. As for himself, "I am for other than for dancing measures," he declared.
"Stay, Jaques, stay," begged the Duke.
"Not to see any pastime," was the grim response.
"If you want anything, I will stay to hear it at your abandoned cave."
Like King Solomon of old, Jaques had tasted all the pleasures of life and had delighted in studying his own fellow mortals. But his stores of wit and wisdom brought him no real satisfaction.
"Vanity of vanities, all is vanity,"
was all that his worldly philosophy had taught him, and his sharp-eyed cynicism saw only the base and ludicrous side of human nature. So he went his way, rejecting the kindly fellowship that was offered him and taking a half-exultant pride in his own loneliness and melancholy. But the Duke ordered the rejoicings to proceed, and the green glades of the Forest of Arden rang with the sound of song and laughter.